So just another day at work killing zombies.
I try, you know, it's either the office or you just take somebody's brains out, you know.
We actually had to censor the last part there.
Did you? Why?
Yeah, well, this is a family program.
Oh. I've become de-censored completely.
Yeah.
I'm so used to seeing it now.
tell me, take us to that set. I mean, this is a huge television hit. And it becomes like, I mean, a factory, I would believe, that where you in production frequently or all the time.
Yeah.
And I guess with that kind of fans that you have, they are rather obsessed.
They're obsessed.
Fans of this zombie thing.
They're amazing, but I have to say, there's got to be some sort of worldwide phenomenon with death. Because it's not just in the States. These shows have become so popular worldwide. People want to see us killing people. They love the more blood, the better. I don't know what that is. Maybe it's a safe way of playing out our sort of deepest, darkest, sick fantasies.
But how is it, will people, I mean, will there be a lot of secrecy? When do you know what's going to happen with all these people in? No.
So they love to keep us in the dark. The actors, we get our scripts maybe hours beforehand. So of course we all think we're going to die. We read everything backwards just to make sure that, you know, we're still alive and kicking. And then, of course...
So that you still have a job, actually,
exactly.
After the episode.
I just bought a house. Okay, I'm good. I'm not going to be homeless. So we read everything backwards because you just never know. And I think the excitement now, especially because of shows like Game of Thrones and The Walking Dead, which is our companion show, when they start killing off characters without anybody expecting it, including us, there's an excitement there. It's very realistic.
Even for
our
the actors.
Our tears are real, is what I'm saying.
Yeah, exactly. And will you have, when there's a lunch break, will you have, like, will you eat with the zombies? Or will you have them in a separate room?
We should keep them in a separate room, but no, they're all welcome. We eat together, and they're usually covered in blood, which is the new sort of formula of blood is very sticky, and it's full of chemicals, so you can smell them from miles away. And the best is when they're just moving, like, you know, a piece of lip away so they can put a fry in. That's the best. But the best is the dreams. When you first start on these shows, you know, most people aren't used to seeing half-dead, reanimated corpses. So you start having these nightmares, at least people who aren't sociopaths, I think. So you start having these crazy nightmares. And then by season two, now they're still there because they've become part of your psyche, but they're just not as scary anymore. So I'm having some very emotional, enlightening dream, and then there's just a zombie in the background. Just useless, just sort of in the backwash that I've become accustomed to, sadly.
Well, if we had a zombie invasion, would NATO be prepared? How would NATO?
NATO is there to protect all allies against any threats, including, of course, zombies.
So you can confirm that you have this secret zombie program that is.
Yes.
It is
I'd
so
like
secret
know.
That I cannot tell about it. So, but you can
tell me, right?
But then afterwards. So, but to be honest, I'm not so very familiar with zombies. So I think we have something to learn there in NATO on how to protect the United States.
Yeah,
and
I think we would be in trouble, actually. Yeah.
I heard, I don't know if this is true. This might be an old wives' tale, but I heard there is actually a part of the CIA that studies what would happen if there was some sort of biochemical warfare that would make people zombie-like. Okay. NATO man.
But the CIA...
Go on.
No, but CIA is, what should I say, working close with NATO. So if CIA is on that...
You're good with it? Okay, great. They've got it handled.
You are actually Swedish.
Part
Swedish.
Hence no blonde hair, no blue eyes.
No, but you left Linköping in Sweden when you were 12.
When I was just about 13, which is a fun age when you don't speak English well yet.
But how could you? I mean, leave Linköping.
Blame my parents. My father got a new job in America, and I was fighting it. I remember my best friend Tommy and I, we were pen pals for a while. This is before cell phones, or at least for a 12-year-old. And I had these grand plans of stealing money somehow so I could buy a plane ticket and come back home. And he was completely encouraging this. Yes, you will move in with my family. We will feed you. We will clothe you. Everything will be well. I don't know how I was going to get this money. I think maybe, you know, zombie sort of school or something. But figure something out. But I was going to get that money.
Kan du prata svenska idag?
I understand it. Sadly, I'm losing it. I can say random word. Quick use it. Ja.
Ja.
Jag älskar dig.
That's enough.
That's all I need, right? Yeah.
That'll get you a long way, yeah. And you do actually speak several languages.
So English.
Yeah.
Farsi. Dari.
Farsi.
Dari is very close to Farsi. I learned that from a movie. French I learned in school. Spanish. And Swedish I'm hoping to go back for one month. I think it'll come back.
It's very impressive.
Thank you.
I think, yeah. Are you a master of many languages?
No, not at all. I actually promised to try to learn some French when I became Secretary General of NATO, and I attended a course for 2 weeks, and I understood that French is a language I will never be able to.
Oh no! I was like, yeah. Okay.
But I think that to start to learn French when you are in the mid-50s is a bit late.
It's difficult if you don't, yeah, you know, speak the Romance languages, because there's a lot of feminine, masculine, mm-hmm, and you know, things that we're not accustomed to if you don't speak language and the other language.
And you forget it if you don't use it. Mercedes, thank you so much for being here with us tonight. Thank you.